Crossroads, let's stand to our feet. Happy Mother's Day. And I can actually say none of us will be here without y'all mothers. Come on, let's sing it out.
Salvation, tearing through the dead of night. See the kingdom burst into color at the speed of light. Freedom, shaking up the atmosphere as the shadows fade into nothing as the day appears.
Sing it out!
Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Kingdom come, see the hope of heaven shining like the rising sun. Now forever lifted up from death to life. There's no fear in love and no darkness in his endless life.
Oh, beyond the sky.
Let's give him an offering of praise in the house this morning. He is worthy. He is worthy. Amen. Well, church, I want to share with you 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9 today. But he said to me, this is Paul. He's speaking of a thorn that he has in his flesh, and he's asked the Lord to take it from him. But the Lord says, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. So Paul says, therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness so that Christ's power may rest on me. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do everything for your glory. We prepare our days and our work for you, Father. But today, Lord, we're not going to lean on our understanding. We're going to allow ourselves to come to a place where we need you. To come to the boundaries of who we are. To the end of our capabilities, because it's at that place we get to watch your majesty unfold. It's there on that cliff at the end of who I am and what I can do. I get to see miracles unfold. I get to see you heal. I get to see you restore. So, Father, today I will not walk in my strength. I will rest in your power. I will rest in your sovereignty. I will make room for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to have his way in my life.
Where I lay it down, every burden.
Church, we have a new song for you this morning. We want you to read the words, and when you feel comfortable, join in and worship with us.
Seek his face, who bend the knee and fix the gate.
sing like you've known His grace. Come on and lift up your holy hands, 'cause He's worthy of all our praise. You're worthy of all our praise. Yes, you are mine.
Come on, Crossroads, He's worthy. Come on, Crossroads, He's worthy. Come on, Crossroads, He's worthy. Hey! Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, Jehovah, we're going to worship You like nobody's looking this morning. Oh, He is worthy, so worthy. He shames every idol. He reigns without rival. He goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. He speaks into nothing, yeah. And darkness goes running. Goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. So call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to Him. Your battles, every single one. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Oh yeah, Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Sing it with me now.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Hey,
Jehovah Jireh, meet your needs.
Yeah,
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Shalom be your peace.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your needs.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your needs.
Oh, let Him hear you.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Let Him be your peace.
Jehovah Shalom be your peace.
Oh, Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Let Him meet your needs.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your needs.
your battle. Every single one. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
He is my healer.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
He is the Prince of Peace.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh.
Amen. He is worthy of our praise. Amen. Amen. Well, isn't it good to be in God's house this morning, Crossroads? Amen. Amen. And we are here honoring our moms. And Proverbs 31:31 says, honor her for all the works that her hands have done. And I don't know about you, but I think of my mom and all that she has done and all that sometimes we put them through. It is a good thing to honor our moms, is it not? And moms, we honor you no matter where you are on campus this morning. We honor you. Would you join me in a prayer of blessing over our moms? Lord, we thank you for this day. And God, we not only pray a prayer of blessing over them, we thank you as we have just sung this song about who you are. Lord, we thank you. Every one of their needs will be met by the power of your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you help me welcome all of our first-time guests here at Crossroads? We are glad you are here. Amen. And there's a way for you to connect on the screen there. Please make sure you do that. We have a gift for you in the lobby. All of our moms, if you would please see in the lobby, we have grannies, acai bowls. We have one for you free as our gift to you. Please make sure you get one of those before you leave and get ready to watch this video.
I have grown tremendously by being part of the School of Ministry. Not only have I expanded my Bible knowledge, but I also feel more confident as a woman in ministry, and I've been able to serve in new capacities that I really didn't feel equipped to be part of before.
In the house. We are so honored you're here celebrating us. We love you and appreciate you. Thanks for coming out in the storm. I mean, you just don't even know these days, right? Like last week we had a flood and now we got a storm. Next week we're expecting locusts, so show up for that, okay? It's gonna be a good time, y'all. But we also want to acknowledge that this can be a Mom's Day can be challenging for some. Your mom might have already been in heaven, might be incarcerated. Let's just be honest. Moms, sometimes we cause pain, so there's that too. There's a lot of reasons it can be difficult. So we acknowledge that, and our hearts are with you, and we love you so much. So thanks for being with us today. We are going to be unwrapping some really cool truths in you today. So I hope you will lean in for that. We've been praying for you. Jesus and I have been talking about you and what is next for you in your life. I do want to encourage you before we dive in too far. Quick Start is happening today at 11:30, right after this service. That is, if you are even anywhere near the beginning of your faith or just want to know more, ask someone out in the lobby. We would love to help you get connected and dive deeper. Quick Start is designed just for you. And I have to just do a quick shout out because our dream team, you guys, dream team hit 400 people this week. Isn't that awesome? Yeah, and that's who you see serving all across the campus in the crazy weather, just giving their hearts for everything. And so we so appreciate that group of people. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you, Lord. We come before you. We set aside our own thoughts, feelings, agenda, or preconceived notions, and we surrender to you. We ask that your will be done, God. Above all, that we want to hear from you. We want to hear your voice. We want to know you more, love you more, serve you more in all that we do. In your precious name, amen. All right, so our theme verse for today is from Luke 22:42, and it is, "Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." It is a verse of surrender. It's God, not what I want, but what you want. And this is our one truth, unwrapping my surrender era. We are going to unwrap what happens when we surrender things in our lives. When I was a kid, my grandparents, they had a grocery store, and they had these little tiny chocolate footballs. Does anybody remember those? It's literally just like pure chocolate wrapped in a football wrapper. I mean, what could be better, right? And so they would just let us have whatever we wanted. They owned the grocery store, and I'd get those little footballs, and I'd run to the end of the aisle where there was a bench, and I'd sit there and unwrap them and just enjoy the chocolatey goodness. And I was thinking about unwrapping what is inside of you today, I believe that there is hidden greatness, beautiful things, delicious, wonderful things inside of you that God wants to unwrap and reveal to you today. So we're going to unwrap our first point, and it is this. It is our first area of surrender, and it's them. We're going to empower. And there's a lot of facets to empower, but because it's Mom's Day, we have to discuss parenting, right? However, even if you're not a parent, if you're a grandparent, if you have influence over anyone younger than you at all, I believe these principles will be very applicable for you. So when it comes to parenting, the Holy Spirit is our lifeline. He is your ally. He is your best friend. You cannot do it without him. And if you are not familiar with the Holy Spirit, let me just tell you, Holy Spirit's not weird, okay? We're weird, right? Okay, look at your neighbor and say, you're weird. Yeah. See, now we all know. We're all weird, okay? So what the Holy Spirit is, in Galatians 5:25, it tells us this. It says, since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Follow the Spirit's leading. So it's a Greek word. It's actually parakletos. And it's two separate words. Para means alongside. And kletos means to walk with. So he wants to walk alongside you. Regardless of whatever you're doing, Holy Spirit wants to walk with you. So you say, how do we do that? It's submission. It's surrender. It's acknowledgement that you are not in control. And we thank God for that sometimes. Amen. It's really good when I'm not in control, honestly. So I have bad news, though, for all of the helicopter parents. Flight deck called, you've been grounded indefinitely. Because here's the thing, you can't be everywhere all the time. You can't do everything. You can't solve everything. But the Holy Spirit can. He can go with them wherever they are. There is no place, no too far. There is no journey too small. Anywhere that you cannot be, the Holy Spirit is still with them. So if we learn to empower our children or those that we have influence over, and we allow them the opportunity to make the right choices when faced with difficult decisions versus when you try to control everything and expect them to just remain under your control. We were never meant to do that. We were meant to empower them because they're not mine, right? They're not ours anyway. We are stewards. You need to look at your neighbor and say, they're not yours. There's a huge difference between empowering young people to make good choices and lovingly offering correction when they don't. So I just want you to think about that, whether you're empowering them or setting them up. And this is how we do that. We simply say, you can say this to anyone at any age, I believe. What is Holy Spirit saying to you in this situation? Gives them the opportunity to make a choice on their own. Holy Spirit wants to walk alongside of you and those in your life. Our daughter, who is 23, her nickname since she was two, her second birthday party was Ladybug. And I don't know how, but this Ladybug nickname has stuck for a really long time. So obviously every time I see a ladybug, I think of her. And I was at the creek one day, I was doing a little workout by the creek, and I saw a ladybug kind of roaming around, and obviously I picked it up, you know, and I was letting it like crawl all over my hand, and I was talking to it like it was a baby. I was like, little ladybug, you know, and I was having like a whole conversation with it. And then I was like, okay, this is getting weird. I should probably let it return to its normal life. And so I set the ladybug back down where I had found it, and it was like on its back doing that whole like, you know, like it couldn't get off of its back, right? So I kept like trying to flip it over, and every time I'd flip it over, it would land on its back, like did it like three times. And finally I hear the Spirit of the Lord say to me, let it be. I was like, seriously? Like, I did this to her. I made her like stuck on her back. And he's like, let it be. So finally, I listened, went back to my workout, finished the next set. When I look down, the ladybug is just cruising along on her own, exactly as she was supposed to be. Some of us need to let them be. You need to let them figure out how to get off their back on their own. Look at your neighbor, tell them, let them be. It's not up to me. And Jesus' mom is the ultimate example of empowering. And we're going to read in John 2, verses 1 through 12. And this is such a great story. I think that Jesus' mom had relational equity at this point. She knew him. So she knew exactly what to do when this situation came about. And I know she has a name, but for this story, I like to call her Jesus' mom. So on the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. And he says, I love this verse because, you know, verse 4, we like to look at it as like Jesus is being sassy, right? Like, woman, you know, like, do you not read it like that the first like few times? Woman, why do you involve me? Like, that's... And he replied, my hour has not come. Really? I think Jesus was just like, nah, no thanks. You know, I don't really, but I don't know. Maybe he was being sassy. His mother said to his servants, do whatever he tells you. She opened a door to a choice. Nearby stood 6 stone water pots, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to his servants, fill the jar with water so they are filled to the brim. Okay, we're going to skip down. Basically, the master of the banquet's like, this is the best wine ever. Verse 11, what Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which they revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples, and they stayed there a few days. Okay, so we see why women love Jesus, right? Because he's a winemaker and he loved his mama, right? He's a good guy. But there's so many interesting things in this story. She empowered him the opportunity to flex his muscles. She didn't fight him over it. She didn't keep nagging him. We'll let that one slide. She had enough trust and relational equity for when it was time to move, she opened the door and allowed him to move. And then, I think it's so key, that last verse, they hung out afterwards. She had enough relational equity that afterwards, they hung out. And I really think, I don't know, this is creative liberty, but I kind of think it was like, I think he gave her a fist bump and was like, thanks, Mom, you were right, it was my time. There's a song that... it's called Mama Knows. It's actually by Shenandoah, and there's a lyric that says, Mama knows, sometimes I think she's got a window to my soul. Even when I think it doesn't show, Mama knows. Mom has to know what empowering looks like. It's when to listen, it's when to love, it's when to stop, it's when to go. I love the fact that there is no record of Jesus' mom coming out with her angry mom voice and being like, you go do this. I said you do this right now or else. We don't see that in scripture. She simply opened a door for what she already knew was inside of him and allowed him the opportunity to walk through it. The window to my soul. It is literally how we are made by God, and I'm going to show you that in just a minute. You may see more than those around you see. They may not be able to see it yet. So you have to fight for them in prayer. You have to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. He walks alongside of you. And you have to understand that the window to my soul is a responsibility to empower someone around you. Amen? All right, so also important note, this is not limited to your own flesh and blood. This is limited to anyone that you have the blessed opportunity to do life with or have influence over. Both of my children have middle school teachers who saw something in them that we had not yet seen and said, I see this gifting in you. Roll with that. Be empowered by that. We have to empower someone around us. Are you willing to do that today, church? Amen. All right, we're going to surrender. We're going to unwrap point two. We're going to surrender what is hidden. Okay, hidden. This is not like your hidden packages that where you hid your purchases from your husband. That's not what this is. That's a bad kind of hidden. This is the good kind of hidden. Did you know there's a good kind of hidden, okay? This is like, you remember when you were a kid at Christmas and like you just show up on Christmas morning and you're like, where was all of this stuff? It had to be in the house last night, right? So this is the good kind of hidden. In Genesis, when Adam says, I need a helper, I don't think God was caught off guard. Eve was already inside of him. She was just hidden and not yet revealed. And before birth, where's the baby? The baby's hidden in a womb for 9 months. That time is quite literally formative. Even these first 30 years of Jesus' life, as we saw, his first miracle was not until he was 30. So he was not yet revealed. I don't think we celebrate hidden moments and choices in our lives enough. Do not mistake what is unseen for unimportant. Most of the pivotal moments, seasons of lives, the necessary knows, the formative years, they are all hidden. So we have to stop invalidating the hidden seasons and allow God to work through those. Can we do that together? Amen. Okay, so y'all, I love this because the Bible is like a treasure hunt, right? Every time you read it, you learn something new. And there are hidden things in the Bible. That's why you have to dive in and look for them. And so if you will allow me, we're going to be a little bit nerdy for a minute. We're going to look at some hidden treasures in the Bible. There's a verse in Proverbs 25:2 that says, it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search it out. That's you. You're the king. There are things hidden, and we get to search them out. So, as you know, part of the Bible is written in Hebrew, okay? And so there are symbols that are used to make up the words. Even the word for letter in Hebrew, it actually means like sign or wonder or heavenly revelation. So there are a lot of things that we can unwrap when we start looking at this. And I just want to show you a couple. When God first created Adam, it was a neutral term, okay? So it was simply meant human. At that time, it didn't yet mean man. All references to Adam were actually like gender neutral. Not until God takes some of Adam's flesh and makes a woman, at that point does the reference man come. Adam is never called man until the woman has been separated from him. And if we look at Genesis 1:27, this is where we first see these references. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. male and female. Okay, so in Hebrew, they don't really use a lot of vowels. It's mostly consonants. So I figured out also when doing this study, so many things that I learned. My husband, I think he texts in Hebrew. He doesn't use vowels either. Anybody else? You have males in your life? Yeah, there are a lot of males probably do that. You just didn't know. Now we know you're texting in Hebrew. So there are two there's a different word for woman and man, and you can see their relevance and their similarity. There are two symbols that are the same in both the word woman and man. There's one symbol that's different. So for the female, if you see the symbol that's in pink, do you notice what it looks like? Looks like a window. It's actually called hey, which is fun. Like, it's fun that we get the fun word. Everybody say, hey. Yeah, you got to say it like that, though. Hey, you know. You got to do a lean with it, I think, too. It means behold, look, to see. It means to see what is hidden. Women, you were literally formed to see, to behold. That is how we are made at surface level. And then for the man, the symbol, it kind of looks like a bicep, doesn't it? Do you see that? It is intended to be an arm or a strength. It's called a yod. And it's reaching towards heaven. There is a strength implied in this. So here's the beauty. This is what's so great. If you take the yod and the hey together, you see them in the word Lord, which is Yahweh. Because together we make the image of God. Amen. Can you give him praise for that? God is so cool. If all this is hidden in these few little tiny words and symbols in Scripture, what is hidden inside of you? God has things that he wants to draw out of you, to reveal who you are. You are intricate. You are detailed. The way that you are made is not like anybody else, and it was not supposed to be like anyone else. So you have to unwrap and see what he designed that is specific to you. How do you connect with him? How do you soak in him? How do you learn and grow? So I'm just challenging you to take the time and not rush through, but uniquely discover how you can walk intimately with the King. Will you do that? Will you soak in him today? Amen. And for our last point, point number three, is when you surrender the weight, you find a treasure. We all love a good treasure, right? But hidden comes first, treasure often comes later. And we know, we saw these first 30 years of Jesus' life was hidden. But when we read the Bible, if you look at these Bible characters, a lot of times we're just reading like chapter to chapter, right? So we're like, oh, well, that happened quick. That's awesome. You know, problem resolved. In reality, there is a long time period between dream and reality. Joshua had a dream about his future, and then he went to prison for 13 years. David, he was anointed king. What did he do? He went right back to tending the sheep. It would be a dozen years before he was able to wear that crown. Sarah, we know that she was promised a son at a very mature age, and yet it was still 25 years before she got to hold that promised son. Joseph had a dream. He was going to save his family. It was 20 years before he even saw them again. Esther, Moses, Paul, the list goes on and on. You see the point. We have to surrender the waiting period in order to get to the treasure. And we know this for sure, but we have the ability to sabotage our future by refusing to wait upon God in the present. Because waiting is not passive. It's prayerful. It's spiritual. It's alert. It's protecting the promise in prayer of where you are at right now. And so I want to challenge you that if you're in a waiting season, in a struggle, waiting for something, that you might have to rebrand the situation, right? Because when we look at the negative, that's what we think about, and that's how we spin it, and we only talk about that. But if we rebrand it, then we're looking at something else. When our kids were little, I used to always make spaghetti, right? And so they were used to eating spaghetti, and they liked spaghetti. And then one day, I really expanded my culinary expertise, and I made lasagna. Yeah, so talented. And but then you present them lasagna and they'd not seen it before. And they're like, what is this? Like, I don't like that. You know, of course, small children. And I'm like, it's the same ingredients, like literally the exact same ingredients. There's like two different maybe. I don't know. Haven't made it in a long time. But anyway. So I rebranded the situation. I said, it's Spaghetti's twin brother. And they love it. They thought it was fantastic because it was Spaghetti's twin brother. So here's what you need to do. You need to rebrand the situation. Maybe you're at Success's twin brother right now. Maybe you need to say, I am in my grateful era. I am in my era of speaking life. I am in a waiting season, but I am walking with Jesus the whole way. Rebrand the wait. Amen. We have to be okay to go from not accomplishing, but to becoming. Because he is more worried about your to-be list than your to-do list. Who are you becoming, not what are you doing? We all love to check that box. Matthew 16:23 says this, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. That phrase, merely human concerns, that's where we spend most of our mental real estate. That's why we have to shift our focus up. That's why we have to rebrand the situation so that we're leaning into him. We're choosing to hear him. We're focused on what he has next. Exodus tells us that the Lord would speak to Moses face to face, just like a friend. And that is exactly what he wants to do with you. He wants to speak to you. He wants you to lean in. He wants you to know him more, to hear him more, to see him more every single day. So as we unwrap our surrender era, when we surrender every area of our lives to God, it will empower a hidden treasure that is inside of you. That's what happens when we follow the Spirit. Amen. Can you give him an applause, church? He's good. He is so, so good. So I want you to, as you leave here today, I want you to think about our theme verse of nevertheless, not my will, but yours. In just a minute, they're going to sing I Surrender All. It's one of my favorite songs because all is, it's encompassing. There is nothing left. So whatever it is in our lives, God, we give it all to you. There is nothing for me to hold on to. And he takes our sins as far as the east is from the west. He releases them. Stand with me to your feet, please. Bow your heads all across this place as we just allow our hearts to connect with the King. As we listen to what Holy Spirit has to say to each of us, he speaks to us on a personal and individual level. So Spirit, we set aside all of our own thoughts, emotions, distractions, anything that would hold us back from you, God. Lord, we only want what you have for us, God. We are surrendering everything to you, God, our hearts and our lives. And so there are two types of people in the room I want to pray with this morning. If you have never made a public declaration of faith, we want to pray with you. You want to say, Jesus, I know that you are the Son of the living God, and make him the King of your heart. In just a few moments, I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. And the second type of people in the room is, if you've known him, but you need to reaffirm your faith. James tells us that sometimes people walk away from the faith, and we know that this world can quickly pull us away from him. But to you, we say, welcome home. We have been waiting for you. We love you, and the King will shout in victory as you lean in today. I'm going to count to three. Don't hesitate. Don't wait. One, two, three. Raise your hands all across this place. Amen. I see you. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Thank you, sir. Hallelujah. Yes. Amen. Thank you, ma'am. Yes. Praise the Lord. We see you. Thank you. Oh, of heaven celebrates with us today. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Father, God, we come before you and we give you our hearts and our lives and our souls. Lord, we surrender everything to you. Not my will, but your will, God. Not what we want, not our thoughts, not our actions, not our choices, God. Yours and yours alone. And we ask that you be the king of our hearts. We rededicate our lives to you. We thank you, Father, for what you're doing in this place. In your precious name, amen. Can you give him one more praise, church? He is so faithful. Our prayer partners are coming to the front. You guys, these people, they fight for you. They believe in you. They would be honored to pray with you. If you have any need in your life, I ask that you just take a moment and allow them to pray with you today. And if you raised your hand, if you'll look to your right, my left, right over here is Mark and Dennis. And they just want to tell you that they love you and pray with you. If you would come visit Mark and Dennis, that would be so amazing. We are honored to worship with you today. Sing with Tori one more time before you go.
And I surrender all.
Come on, sing it to him.
I surrender all and all to thee, my blessed Savior. I will surrender all.
Church, if you need anything, we are here. And in reverence for those who are receiving ministry in this room, we ask that you fellowship in the lobby. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next Sunday.
Yes, I.